Newfoundland, actually, at some point, in the historiography of the British Empire. In his Ford lectures on the decline, revival, and fall of the British Empire, delivered at Oxford in 1974, the great imperial historian John Gallagher claimed that, quote, "There was never any question of amputating the white colonies or dominions from the empire, however tenuous, even metaphysical, their connection with it seemed to become, turning as it did on such questions as Kevin O'Higgins' comma and treaties about halibut." This sentiment, the idea of dominion status, is a series of speed bumps along the inevitable path to independence, illustrates one reason for the lack of prominence of dominions in the historiography of the British Empire until a recent revival of interest. Beginning in the 1960s, historians of the British Empire and the Commonwealth have tended to frame the history of the dominions within the context of the decolonization of Britain's Asian and African possessions after the Second World War. Today, I argue that this context of decolonization has tended to mold the interwar dominions around a narrative of colonial independence. This has had two effects on the treatment of the interwar dominions. In larger imperial histories, the evolution of dominion status in the 1920s and 1930s serves largely as a precedent for decolonization after the Second World War. This narrative also tends to shape histories of the dominions around the attainment of sovereignty, which involves recasting dominion status as a bilateral relationship with Britain, a give and take between dominion national interests and imperial interests. Recently, however, the dominions have become more prominent in the historiography of the empire. The major shift driving this trend has been renewed attempts to examine the empire more holistically as a global entity, where the dominions have again regained center stage within what some historians have referred to as the British world, or taking it one step further, as John Darwin has in a recent book, a British world system. This global view of empire has highlighted the importance of a self-conscious Britishness as part of dominion identity, as well as other economic and political links among the dominions and empire that had been obscured by the dominion-to-nation narrative. The dominions, therefore, have shifted from forgotten corners of empire to the vanguard of the British world. Yet at the same time, growing autonomy and sovereignty remained crucial parts of the contemporary understanding of the dominion status in the 1920s and 30s, not only within the context of decolonization, but within the context of new states formed after the First World War. Therefore, I argue that it also makes sense to look at the dominions through the lens of Britain's interwar international relations. During this time, dominion status developed not only a path from colony to independence, but as a novel type of international relations in its own right. The relationship envisioned by imperialists between the members of the British Commonwealth of Nations served as an important influence for the British approach to internationalism in the interwar period. The tendency to view the dominions as the vanguard of decolonization makes sense in large-scale works examining the empire from the point of view of its gradual dissolution after the Second World War. Major surveys of the Commonwealth are informed by this development. Both Nicholas Mansour's Commonwealth Experience from 1969 and J.D.B. Miller's Britain and the Old Dominion, some classic works, reflect the discord among Britain, the Old Dominions, and the New Commonwealth in the late 1960s. Similarly, David McIntyre's 1977 Commonwealth of Nations examines the evolution of the Commonwealth relationship within the context of Britain joining the European Economic Community in 1973, seen largely at the time as sort of the final shift of Britain from this imperial power to a European power. In these works, the dominions provide the blueprint for the transition from colony to nation through a natural erosion of constitutional barriers to sovereignty. At the other end, histories of the dominions tend to focus on the relationship with Britain and the extent of dominion sovereignty. Historians use a variety of approaches to measure dominion independence. Constitutional historians often grapple with a tendency to introduce change via inscrutable pronouncements from imperial conferences that have baffled historians and contemporaries alike. J.D.B. Miller referred to the 1931 Statute of Westminster that in theory freed dominion legislation from Westminster interference as a masterpiece of ambiguity. Robert Garan, the Australian Solicitor General in the 1920s, described the 1926 Balfour Declaration, which affirmed the autonomy of the Dominions, as contradictory and mystical. It is perhaps not surprising that a history of Australia, entitled Australian Independence, devotes itself largely to answering the question, when exactly did Australia become independent? Constitutionally, it's not particularly clear. Another historical approach involves cataloging disputes between the Dominions and Britain on questions such as foreign policy and trade in order to identify cracks in the relationship between Dominion, Britain, and imperial identities. At the same time, economic historians have examined patterns of trade and finance in order to question the Dominion independence narrative. Keenan Hopkins, for example, pointed to Dominion dependence on British capital as a counterpoint to these assertions of sovereignty. And other historians have illustrated the extent to which the Dominions, and particularly Australia and New Zealand, depended on Britain's protected market well into the 1960s. The decolonization narrative has marginalized the Dominions in the imperial historiography as either too imperial or too local. So at one end, the lack of clear starting and end points, and the attempts to maintain some sort of imperial connection during the 1920s and 30s give this impression of a smooth and inevitable path to sovereignty within the context of Dominion status. But at the other end, Dominion histories that attempt to recast independence as a contentious national struggle against British domination localize these histories and drive them away from the greater narrative of imperial history into Canadian history or Australian history or the like, which has been much more obscure to historians of the larger imperial picture. Either way, the association of Dominion status with decolonization treats Dominion status as this centripetal force allowing for the fractioning of the empire. Yet while the Dominions had become marginal in imperial history, they loomed large in the contemporary imperial imagination. In the early 20th century, imperialist activity focused on developing a closeness among the Dominions through organizations, most notably the Round Table. Even in the 1920s and 1930s, when the Dominions assumed increasingly ostentatious trappings of independence, such as their own foreign ambassadors and seats on the League of Nations Council, official rhetoric about the Dominions emphasized the maintenance of an imperial connection. The attempt to transform the Dominions into the beginnings of what became to be known as the British Commonwealth of Nations emphasized not a break with the British Empire, but a reconfiguration of the empire as a distinct set of international relations. This internationalization of the Commonwealth held important influence on British internationalism in the 1920s and 1930s. The historiographies of the British Empire and British internationalism during the interwar period remain curiously separate. Histories of internationalism tend to center on the failure of international collaboration through the League of Nations to prevent the foreign policy crises that led to the Second World War. The terms of the debate still often refer to E.H. Carr's 20 Years' Crisis from 1939, which interpreted the interwar years as a struggle between utopian internationalists and hard-headed realists. The Dominions tend to have brief cameos, antagonizing the Japanese delegation at the Paris Peace Conference, mystifying the United States Senate with demands for separate votes at the League of Nations Assembly, and solidifying the British economic bloc at the Ottawa Conference in 1932. This conception of internationalism, however, tends to overlook the significant influence of the idea of the Commonwealth on the British view of internationalism. Relations among Britain and the Dominions, in fact, served as an important lens through which British officials approached the League and internationalism during the 1920s and 1930s. Now, one way that the Commonwealth influenced British internationalism was as a model for the League of Nations. A number of British imperial reform advocates that sought to maintain a connection to the Dominions became involved with the British contribution to the creation of the League of Nations. Their efforts drew direct comparisons between the League and the Empire in several ways. For one, they used imperial institutions, such as the Imperial Conference, as a tangible example of the League's machinery. At the same time, imperial reformers found the less tangible essence of Commonwealth cooperation far more important than any specific organizational aspects. and they began to refer to the British Commonwealth as itself a league of nations. Jan Christian Smuts, the South African defense minister and Commonwealth advocate, at the conference claimed in his influential League of Nations a practical suggestion that today the British Commonwealth of Nations remains the only embryo League of Nations because it is based on the true principles of national freedom and political decentralization. He also referred to the British Empire as a pre-existing lesser league. So by associating the League of Nations with the Commonwealth, these intellectuals and policymakers emphasized the international character of the Commonwealth itself. It also introduced a particularly British version of international relations based on how these intellectuals and policymakers saw relations among Britain and the Dominions. These new Commonwealth relations stressed growing Dominion autonomy in their own finances and politics, and even foreign policy, as they evolved into, at the parlance of the time, their own international personalities. The connection between Britain and the Dominions therefore became more abstract. Imperialists suggested that it came from the shared institution of parliamentary democracy, shared goals in foreign policy, mutual economic support, and agencies facilitating collaboration in industry, agriculture, public health, and other concerns. So what I argue today is that the traditional narrative of seeing the British dominions through this notion of decolonization, through dominion status as this necessary first step to dominion sovereignty, has marginalized the dominions in the historiography of the British Empire, both too imperial at some points, too local at other points. And what I'd like to suggest today is that this idea of recasting dominion status and Commonwealth relations as international relations is another way to return the dominions to prominence, the way they were for imperialist intellectuals and policymakers in the 1920s and 30s, and realize some of the effects that they had on British policy outside of the empire. Thank you.
Thank you. In my paper, I will look at the issue of the constitutional status of British expatriates in India in 1946 to 1947 within the context of a British parliamentary delegation to India in 1946, which is commonly known as the Cabinet Commission. Perhaps the paper would have been better titled as Questions Over Constitutional Status, simply because the issue was never resolved within the context of the Cabinet Commission, but rather it continued beyond. The high-power Cabinet delegation included Lord Pethick Lawrence, who was the Secretary of State for India, Sir Stafford Cripps, who was the President of the Board of Trade, and A.V. Alexander, who was Lord of the Admiralty. And the main objective of this mission was to, quote, work out in cooperation the means by which Indians can themselves decide the form of their own institutions with the minimum of disturbance and the maximum of speed, end quote. And the British Prime Minister issued an additional directive for this mission, which said that any constitutional arrangement must give, quote, some form of safeguards, either by constitutional or treaty provisions for the safeguards of racial and religious minorities, end quote. So when the Cabinet Mission arrived in India in March 1946, they began to meet with various Indian leaders, and one of the constituency whom they met was the British expatriate community in India. On 10th April, they met with Mr. C.P. Lawson, who was a representative of the European Association, which was the organization representing them. And the meeting discussed three main themes. One was commercial safeguards for expatriate businesses. Second was minority status for expatriates. And the third was the question of citizenship. Mr. Lawson told the Cabinet Commission that the expatriates would be willing to accept franchise in an independent India, but insisted that any action taken by the British government on this issue must not endanger negotiation for future commercial treaty between the two countries. And when asked about his views on Indian domicile, Lawson replied that they were not considering such an option and wondered why India cannot have the same attitude as Australia, by which he meant whether India can become a dominion or not. And Lawson stated that India remained within the Commonwealth. Their residence in India might give them franchise rights. And Mr. Lawson also indicated that the British expatriates would like to take part in any future constitution making body. But he emphasized that the negotiation of a treaty between the two countries remained their primary concern. And Mr. Lawson also claimed that the British expatriates did not wish to seek special rights for themselves except what is given to other minorities in India. So to summarize, the meeting between the cabinet mission and the British expatriates indicated that they wish to stay and do business in an independent India, and they also wanted to participate in the constitution making body and design safeguards for their businesses, and they also wish to get classified as minorities because that would allow them to get special seats in any lawmaking body in an independent India. Now the questions over their constitutional status did not arise as a separate issue, but rather occurred within a much larger debate about their participation in the constitution-making body. And just to describe that, I will have to talk about that bigger debate. So the cabinet mission proposed a plan for a constituent assembly, which will eventually frame a constitution for India. But the way that they went ahead with that was they divided the Indian provinces into Section A, Section B, and Section C. Section A were Hindu majority provinces, Section B were Muslim majority provinces, and Section C included Bengal and Assam. So the main argument came about over the Section C about Bengal, because the way that the cabinet mission said to form the constituent assembly was the members from each provinces will actually send representatives to the constituent making body, and as a consequence of the constitutional reforms in the 1930s, the Europeans were given 5 seats out of 27 seats from Bengal, and this violated the cabinet mission's allegation of seats, because they said 1 seat for 1 million Indians, but in total in Bengal they had only 20,000 British expatriates being given 5 seats, and particularly in Bengal the issue became problematic because of the close numbers between Hindus and Muslims. So the number of European seats became a bone of contention between the Indian National Congress and the All India Muslim League, because they both wanted to get a numerical majority, and the 5 seats held by the Europeans became a big point of debate between the Indian National Congress, Muslim League, and the Cabinet Mission. So it is within this broader debate that the question of what is the constitutional status for the expatriates comes into being. Lord Pethick Lawrence raised the idea that the expatriates might make an agreement with Indian National Congress whereby the expatriates might get representation in the Advisory Committee on Minorities in exchange for abandoning their voting rights. And Sir Frederick Burroughs, who was the governor of Bengal, questioned whether British expatriates could be considered as a minority because they are not Indian Indian citizens in the first place. To which Lord Petty-Clausen said that the British expatriates can be a minority even though they may not be Indian citizens. And so Frederick mentioned that the British expatriate might not gain much but by participating in the advisory committee because their interests are mainly commercial in nature, to which Lord Petty-Clausen replied that the advisory committee might also discuss other issues as the question of maintaining their Indian citizenship despite temporary absences abroad. And he indicated that the same issue rose in Sri Lanka about the on the same issue for the expatriate community there, and the whole debate goes on for several days, and finally the British expatriates finally decide not to participate in this whole process, but still they would like to be classified as minorities in an independent India. But the cabinet mission more or less has the final say on this issue when it says that the British expatriates cannot be classified as minorities because they are not permanent settlers in India. And this stance, like in my opinion, merely skirts around the issue because the British expatriates had earlier in the meeting with Lawson said that they would consider Indian domicile if that is the final option. So in my opinion, the question over the constitutional status of British expatriates reveals the lack of concern about them in both among the Indian government and in the British government, particularly when there is higher priority for actually ensuring a smoother transfer of power. Most of my colleagues in today's conference would probably explain the nature of their intellectual debt to Professor Hopkins at the beginning of their own individual presentations. However, I would like to state mine at the end because of the nature of my debt. Most of the members of this room are aware of Professor Hopkins' famous question, so what? The point being to ask the importance and the relevance of a particular piece of research. Usually the question is posed at the end of a presentation, and I would like to anticipate it by giving some answers. First, by examining the links between business and decolonization, actually work done by other scholars such as Maria Mishra, Sarah Stockwell, Nicholas White, and Robert Trignor. And looking at the constitutional aspects of this issue will help us better understand how expatriate businessmen conceptualize citizenship and their movement across rapidly emerging national boundaries. There exists a large amount of scholarship on migration and the historical efforts to control it. And by focusing on the constitutional aspects of expatriate businessmen, we can integrate these two scholarships. And the second use, which is more limited like in scope because it's more important for the Indian historiography, is to it will help us to reassess the impact of the constitutional reforms of the 1930s and look at how it had an impact on making of policies. And finally, it also helps us to look at the issue of minority status, whether the British expatriates constitute a racial minority in India or do they merely constitute a numerical minority. Thank you.
Next we'll have Adam Pepper.
Thank you. So I'm going to discuss child labor. And what I'd like to do is, since this is in honor of Dr. Hopkins, I'm going to take a shot at the controversy, as well as focus more on economics in terms of child labor than some of the social issues that are associated with it, although I won't make a few comments on that. So what I would like to do to begin with is I will discuss what we should include in child labor. What does that mean in terms of activities? And then from there, I'll make some overview of some of the economic ideas currently associated with child labor, and then related to some of Dr. Hopkins' work and some other items. So what I would like to propose is that how we view child labor currently is in a large way dictated by our understanding of the Industrial Revolution and the role of child labor in factory work. And there's a large, or at least a growing number of historians in both the US, Britain, and Russia who are looking at child labor before the Industrial Revolution and how activities of children associated with labor transfer into factory work. Some of them will be Ruth Herndon on the U.S. side, and Boris Borchkov, and on the Russian side, who begins his work about 1840. So if then child labor begins before the Industrial Revolution, then what does that mean in terms of what we include in child labor? So I think the definition needs to be redefined, and this is part of the way where I'm going to seek to be controversial. First of all, I would argue that it includes all direct labor activities, such that child labor includes all activities a child performs associated with the production or sale of goods and services. Okay, so this opens up looking at child labor as a part of household economies and other such activities. I'll also go further to say that it includes some of activities not directly associated with the child's production itself, but the child labor relates to activities a child engages in where another member of the household becomes free to perform activities related to the production of goods or services, in the sense that if the child is given a task to allow a mother or a father to engage in economic activity, then the actions of that child are related to the production of goods and services. And then finally, the third aspect where I try to be the most controversial is an idea that Peter Stearns has suggested, but not actually, I've not seen where he's developed it more, is that child labor also can include choices. And this relates to a economic definition of human capital, where education is a form of increasing the value of human capital so that a person can achieve a higher level or increased level of income later on based on their education. So I would argue that education itself can be viewed as a form of child labor. Now, this sounds absurd at first, but take an issue like apprenticeship. Is that education or is that labor? And the fact of the matter, it's both. So what I'm saying is looking at child labor broadly, if you want to use the analysis tool and say the lingerie or whatever, and look at child labor and see how children shift from different economic and education activities depending on specific economic and social conditions at that time. So then we're talking about not an end or a beginning to child labor, but a broader argument of how children fit into economies and society over a period of time. Now, what are the consequences of defining child labor in this way? What it means is we have to disband the idea of child labor as being a purely negative activity, so that it opens it up to a broader definition where child labor can include both positive or negative activities depending on given circumstances. Okay, so what that also means is then things associated with the Industrial Revolution, such as child wage labor or piecemeal work, is just one aspect of child labor that we can still say that this, depending on situations, can be very detrimental to a child's health and so on. But it opens it up to understand the role of children in the economy beyond just those kinds of activities. So the next issue then is, what can we say about economic theory or arguments about economics and child labor in this respect? And there's a couple of assumptions we make about child labor that actually don't play out. One of them is that poverty is the reason for child labor. It is true that that can be a reason, but not the sole reason for child labor. Now, two economists, Kashi Basu and Fan Huang Van, did some contemporary work on economics and child labor, in which they used some economic tools such as Pareto efficiency to suggest that actually, if because there's been this movement to say that there should be to abandon or to make illegal child labor in the developing world, one of their argument was is that they found based on their data that if you abolish child labor, that does not necessarily mean that great wages will rise for adults and that there will be no poverty. What the research suggests that actually it depends on the particular economy, because there could be a situation where if you abolish child labor, that there will not be an increase, a representative increase in the adult wage. And so then you will increase poverty rather than reduce it. And there's also the flip side where yes, there are cases where if you abolish child labor, that it will increase the adult wage. So what that seems to suggest then, and I could bring in Sen as well, his argument related to famine and poverty, that you can have an economic system where there can be a surplus of food and still have famine or poverty, depending on particular economic conditions that prevent people from having enough money to purchase a higher cost food item. And their arguments are somewhat related between those two. So what this opens up is the understanding that if we look at child labor more broadly beyond the Industrial Revolution, we find that some of the reasons for child labor aren't just for economic profit, but they're part of a socializing process and a process of training that families or societies make in relation to their children. So that economics being not necessarily the only reason for child labor explains why some of these societies, even though child labor may not appear to be completely necessary, it is used as a way of education and socializing. And that is the one aspect in which child labor especially plays out in a colony like Nigeria. So I want to read a quote by an Igbo woman named Rosanna Ogwe, and she was speaking to a group of British officials, and this is in 1930, and she says, "As regards government schools, when one was opened by government in our town, we regarded it as a very good institution. They allowed a lot of boys to be admitted into the school. At first, our people were reluctant to send their boys to the school. Later on, we found that it was a very good thing to send our boys to the school, and it was suggested that a child of 5 years should be admitted to the school. When a boy of that age is placed in the school, he would not be allowed to learn the customs of his town. If he remains in school and gets a standard 3 or 4, it is said that he should be sent to college. This child's parents must have been paying 1 shilling a month for his school fee, though with great difficulty. When the boy gets a standard 4, it is said that he should go to college, where his parents would be asked to pay £12 annually. The parents cannot afford to pay such a big sum of money. As a result, the boy remains at home and cannot get on with his learning. He is thus neither educated nor uneducated, and there becomes useless, both for manual labor and clerical work. The final result is that the boy becomes useless in the world. That is a great trouble on part of his parents." So what this opens up, I want to evaluate this quote a little bit in the sense that families in Nigeria made educated choices that you can relate it to Hopkins' idea of markets and the role of markets in the sense of a labor market. that they had a value for education, but they balanced what they believed would be the value of education versus the future prospects for a child. And it also suggests the role of the socializing process for children, the importance that they placed on the child understanding the customs and how things work within the local household economy. So let me move to some final mentions of economics and Hopkins. Hopkins in his Economic History of West Africa made a couple of points by talking in the beginning of his book talking about the role of household economics in Africa, and also the difference between Africa and some of the West in terms of the position, or in terms of the productivity being measured by an individual versus productivity in terms of land use. So I would argue that the socialization idea of child labor in Nigerian communities is closely tied to this idea of maximizing the productivity of the individual. The idea that the evil woman is talking about, that the child is useless because he hasn't been trained in how things are done locally, is detrimental to this idea of the child being productive. And I think I'll end there and move on.
Next speaker is Richard Lutz.
Thank you, Ralph. I'm actually glad that Hopkins isn't here. Because it'd be a little embarrassing to see the change of position that I'm taking in regard to Hopkins' work. And the first article I ever published was a critique of his Economic History of West Africa. And I thought it was a devastating critique, by the way. Not that it ever bothered him. But what I do in this paper is actually to do an opposite thing, and that is actually to draw on a piece of Hopkins' work that most of you probably don't even know about, and that's an op-ed piece he did in 2003, just after the U.S. invaded Iraq. And part of that has to do with the fact that, you know, we know there are two things that have become really important about that. We know Hopkins' contribution in terms of economic history. We know his contribution to British imperial history and about globalization. But less well known is his actual role as a public intellectual. Being a public intellectual is not an easy task. And particularly under the Bush administration, where anybody who went against the Bush administration was subject to incredible vitriol and criticism. A lot of guts. So I actually want to read you a couple of sentences from that op-ed piece, which I think is so important in using academic knowledge, his own knowledge, to try to have public policy implications. So let me read you this thing that this op-ed piece that came out on the 23rd of March, 2003, 4 days after the U.S. invasion. According to the latest official reports, the United States envisions a short, necessary occupation in Iraq lasting months, and intends to have the structure of post-Saddam society in place within a year. If this occurs, the world will witness an exercise in social engineering on a scale of intensity never before contemplated, still less achieved. Unfortunately, history demonstrates that there is room for skepticism. In the 19th century, when Europe's great modern empires were assembled, Britain and France formulated civilizing visions that were equally wide-ranging and optimistic. Everything we know about the civilizing mission of the 19th century reveals how difficult it is to convert others to different ways of thinking and how consistently the difficulties were underestimated. Of course, the Bush administration never listened to anything like that, let alone draw on history. And we're still, of course, in Iraq. So what I do in this paper is to take this insight from Hopkins and to try to apply it to the concept of unintended consequence. And there's another thing that I try to do here, and that is I take from Hopkins' work on globalization, this idea that globalization is not about a European program somewhere else, but it's about what he calls a joint production, in which there is an encounter between an imperial set of objectives and a local set of actors. And so I try to use this in framing the particular paper that I have. But that, of course, takes me back to this idea of the law of unintended consequences, and try to think about where that comes from. And the law of unintended consequences was articulated, of course, it has its roots in 19th century sociology, but it is articulated by Robert Merton in 1936. And that's when it becomes and when it enters the public policy lexicon. And the thing that becomes important about Merton is what he defines as analyzing the consequences of what he calls purposeful social action, what we would now call public policy. And he says that there are always unanticipated consequences due to the existing state of our knowledge. And there are two parts to that that are important. The first is ignorance, because our existing state of knowledge, we can't anticipate everything that goes on. And the second part is error, because out of that ignorance is an error about both objectives and outcomes. And those become very important in understanding the unintended set of consequences. So what I do in this paper is to look at the unintended consequences in three areas, three themes that I look at within empire and Africa. The first is the role of intermediaries. Ralph and I have been going back and forth on intermediaries for a long time. And what Ralph doesn't know is that I'm doing a project now with a Senegalese colleague. We're trying to assemble a huge database of personnel dossiers of African colonial employees who worked for the West African Federation. And I was just in Dakar a week ago, doing a seminar on how to do history in the archives using these dossiers. And of course, what's important for the students working on this is one dossier is not enough. You always have to find that no one life is adequate in doing that. So the question is, how do you go about getting students to do this? But the idea of intermediaries is important and goes back to this theme of unintended consequences and joint production that Hopkins is so important about. And what I did in this edited collection I did on African intermediaries is talk about the fact that many African intermediaries who were quick to work for the colonial state had their own set of agendas. And they straddled in many ways both worlds. They straddled the colonial world, and they straddled in many ways the kind of world outside the colonial space. And they had different objectives. And so it was very important to think about how these intermediaries who were quick to learn European languages, quick to parse concepts that were so crucial to build the colonial state, and how they could use that to promote their own set of interests. And there's a lot of fascinating work that comes out of that joint production, allowing us to see how Africans had agency within this context, which is important part of our commitment in African history more generally. The second theme that I look at in this paper has to do with the issue of the protectorate, the unintended consequences of creating a protectorate. In the earlier panel, we talked a little bit with Sean about this place of the protectorate in global legal order itself. And one of the problems is that the protectorate becomes one of the most widely used mechanisms for laying claim to empire, but it's not well understood what it meant. In fact, it's a very vague concept. But it does enshrine this idea that there's two different kinds of sovereignty. There's an external sovereignty and an internal sovereignty. But what I try to do in this section in the paper is to look at the unintended consequences of internal sovereignty, particularly because internal sovereignty was not left intact. This is where, for all imperial powers, they reserved for themselves the right to intervene whenever they felt there were processes that were not germane to civilization. So they would intervene continuously. But it nonetheless had significant interventions and unintended consequences. And here I trace one of the things I've done in previous research is the way in which Africans were quick to use these hybrid colonial institutions, native courts, and particularly how women use these native courts to pursue divorces, something that they couldn't do under what we would call customary law, or better phrased as indigenous law, that except for Islam, there's not a provision for African women to pursue divorce, but colonial courts, native courts, designed to apply custom, became venues for this joint production of history and for this opportunity for Africans to exert agency. Of course, once the Europeans realized that they were providing this opportunity for women to seek their own autonomy, they began to cut back on that opportunity. And that's a fascinating part of the story of unintended consequences. Once they realize that they try to impose something else, which then, of course, has its own unintended consequences. So the third part of this, third theme that I look at, has to do with the ways in which imperial subjects appropriate the civilizing mission rhetoric to undermine Western hegemony. And I go back, actually, to the Iraq case that Hopkins used. And I draw on the provisional coalition authority's project of creating caucuses, which was itself totally undemocratic. And there I contrast that with the Ayatollah al-Sistani, the big Shiite leader, who wanted free and fair democratic elections, fully aware, of course, that there was a Shiite majority and they would win. But see, that was part of the unintended consequences of using Western rhetoric to undermine the colonial project, in this case, the imperial project of the United States and Iran. And then I apply that also to the case of Western education, because one of the fascinating things about Western education is the way in which colonial subjects were able to use issues about development, issues about rights, and to turn that against the colonial authorities and the mainstream. And I draw on this obscure book written in the 1950s by a psychologist in Ghana, who did a series of case studies with students in the 1950s. And this psychologist, of course, was phrased in all of this kind of weird psychology of the 1950s, but the net result, the outcome of that, is really important. Because students who had just gone through primary education felt dependent, but those that had gone on to high school and post-secondary education felt empowered, actually, to criticize the colonial state and the colonial project itself by using the very concepts of the civilizing mission of the mind. So those are part of the unintended consequences that I look at. It's a wonderful concept. It's messy, just like empire is messy. Thank you, Brad.
Our last speaker will be Jason Moore.
All right, well, good morning. When I was first made aware of this conference, I was trying to figure out how to fit my own work on Peruvian nationalism and foreign policy into some of Hopkins' frameworks. And I remembered his 2008 article, Rethinking Decolonization, right, where he argues that when we talk about decolonization of the British Empire, we should be looking at the dominions, which are often overlooked, and their process of decolonization. And in his vision of South Africa, I mean, he brings up the common ideas, you know, apartheid, and its split between, you know, the whiteness that South Africa is trying to, you know, give to the world, or give the world that idea, but, you know, argue that that's the link that's holding in Britain, particularly in the 60s, withdrawal from this. And I think there's a complicating factor to the South African and the withdrawal from the British Empire, and that is the case in Namibia. South Africa's own imperial ambitions in Namibia, particularly in the post-World War II period, led to large number of conflicts between South Africa and the British, particularly in the international community. The South Africans kind of believed that the British and the other dominions and the rest of the Western world would follow through with their plans in 1946 and 44, 45, 46 in particular, of annexing Southwest Africa or Namibia into the Union. Namibia had been granted to South Africa by the League of Nations to rule as a mandate in the immediate post-World War I period. And because of the sharing the geographic boundary with Namibia, South Africa had often ruled Namibia as a province, as part of South Africa as a whole. And with the collapse of the League of Nations during the World War II period, they were hoping that they could slip and formally annex Namibia into, you know, South Africa. And so the 1940s the United Nations began this huge debate on what to do with Namibia. South Africa's hope was to just slip this through and to fully incorporate, complete their colonization of Namibia, and have it legally justified. However, they came across severe opposition to this, particularly from India and other newly independent nations. And I have two kind of examples of that I'm going to focus on today in the limited time I have on what South Africa's goals were, how they viewed the United Nations, and particularly reference to Namibia and the British relationship, and then in 1945-46, and then how this transitioned and where they were let down, they felt, in 1959. You have there's a Southwest administrator, South African administrator of Ovamboland, the northern portion of Namibia, who had been responsible to go to the League of Nations once a year and to give their cursory report of saying, oh, we're doing wonderful things for Namibians, you don't need to look into this, have a nice day, and leaving, right? And they tried to do this again in 45, 46, and again, throughout the 1950s. Well, this man, C.H. Hahn, goes to the United Nations in 1945, 46, and even in the late 40s, towards the end of his career. And he gets really disillusioned with this, what he believed the United Nations would be set up as, like, this imperial project, right? The holding on of, you know, holding back the rest of the world and white empire still controlling it. And especially the fight and then for the incorporation of Namibia really, you know, embittered him. And he wrote a letter to a friend, friendly just is identified as Alfie. I don't know who Alfie is, but the letter starts out saying normal things like, hey, I'm sending my luggage to you since I'm not going back to Ovamboland, I'm leaving Namibia and I'm going to South Africa. So when you get my luggage in Cape Town, will you please figure out where I am and send it to me? It's very vague and kind of interesting. But then he ends it with a short description of how he feels the future of the United Nations is going and the way that he experienced this. And I'm going to read this paragraph. He says, the trip to America was not all beer and Skittles. It was intensely interesting, but we got it in the net good and proper. This is all due to those blasted Indians and Russians having formed a solid bloc and having got the majority of the lesser Dago and half-breed peoples to vote against us. All the Nordic races, with one or two exceptions, voted for us. In my opinion, UNO cannot last at this rate, for it will simply mean that civilization will go back, that the advanced and civilized people will have to dance to the tune of Latin America led by India and Russia. India, by the way, I might tell you, is going all out against the white man. This may be a good thing because she will thereby create a Western bloc, which Russia must join so as to preserve herself. This sounds high politics, but all the indications point that way. Actually, it'll be a damn good thing if the white races could withdraw altogether from those yellow areas and leave them to develop without European guidance and brains. It's like he arrives, in 45, leaving the League of the United Nations is going to be just like the League was, this old imperial good old boy club, and leaves with this feeling of, you know, the colored masses are going to kill us, right, overrun us. And it's really a good capture of the South African opinion in the 1940s of what they're really looking at in this worldwide expression of nationalism and beginnings of globalization or whatever term we want to use here. And they really expect this idea, like Hopkins mentions in Rethinking Decolonization, the white dominions, that the white world will band together to prevent the Commonwealth from becoming the multi-ethnic organization that it does, to prevent the United Nations from being this multi-ethnic entity that it becomes, and are continuously disappointed by this reaction of what's going on, particularly as the 1950s develops and into the 60s when you have a large number of African nations now joining the United Nations. But this feeling of loss, this feeling of how are we supposed to, you know, advance. So that's kind of what they're looking at. And at the same time as all this is going on, Namibian nationalists, beginning with people like, say, Kakko and the Herero Chiefs Council, and later and Swapo and other national organizations are appealing directly to the United Nations for support, making sure that Namibia continues to be an international issue. South Africa, after withdrawing or leaving the United Nations in the late 40s, after losing this battle of incorporation, really retreating this mentality of, we have a League of Nations mandate, this says what we can do to Namibia, and that's what we are going to do. And it's an internal decision that you cannot be a part of. That becomes pretty much their official position all the way up until, really, Namibian independence in 1990. Well, Namibian nationalists and students had been writing letters, smuggling out, recordings, anything they could to get to New York, to appeal to the United Nations to keep this Namibian question on the docket. And it doesn't go away. In 1945 to 1990, there are hundreds and hundreds of meetings every year on what to do about Namibia. There's even a whole committee, the question of Southwest Africa. And in this, South Africa is, of course, really trying to clamp down on any kind of material leaving Namibia. They are refusing visas. They are refusing passports. They are revoking passports from those who had them to prevent them from any way getting to or getting out of Namibia. And there's one case that emerges in 1959 of a Namibian student who is, colored is the term they would use. They write in mixed ethnicities. Named Hans Buchs. Hans Buchs writes in the 1950s, the United Nations, talking about the horrors of apartheid being implemented, the human rights violations that happened, the treatment of Namibians, basically arguing and saying that under the League of Nations mandate, you're supposed to uplift the indigenous people, and in fact, they're stepping on our necks, is the basic theme that he's going here. Well, the United Nations invites him to come to New York to address the Committee on Namibia, and as soon as this happens, as soon as the South Africans find out that he's been invited, they revoke his passport. Well, he decides he's going to go anyway. He hitches a ride across the Kalahari Desert through Botswana, arrives in Salisbury, Zimbabwe, or Southern Rhodesia at the time period, and is able to secure a flight on British Airways to London. And when he gets to London, he goes to the U.S. consulate and embassy and says, I would like a visa to come to the United States to address the United Nations. The United States grants him this visa, and an international firestorm breaks out, at least a small one, at least, right? The South Africans are furious about this. There are South African newspapers, Namibian newspapers are just blowing up with, how is this man, this student, been able to flee our borders? How has he been able to? These questions of sovereignty. Why has he been allowed to travel through not one, but two, and starting to be three British protectorates in the territories in London itself without any kind of travel documentation whatsoever? How is this going on? And then how are the Americans allowing him a visa? The United States response, and I only have the South African side of what they're saying, and the responses, some of the Americans and British, I'm hoping to get to both those national archives to see what they're saying about this internally. But the South Africans are just really upset. This is a violation of our sovereignty. You're allowing these, our own nationals who are subversive and communists, right? You gotta bring that one in there, they're communists, to flee our borders, to address the United Nations, to degrade not just us, but this entire imperial project and the white world as a whole. The Americans are very simple, saying, look, when the United Nations was in New York, we had a deal that says anybody that wants to come, we have to let them come. That's part of the deal. The United Nations wants them here, we bring them. They apply for the visa, we gave it to them, not our problem. And these are going from, the South African foreign minister himself is writing these letters, right? It's at the highest level. The British, on the other hand, are kind of left saying, yes, you're right. We don't have this same obligation the United States does. And yes, through every stage of the game, he was actually stopped in Botswana at one point, asked for travel papers and explained what, and the story is kind of, he's let go on. And so the South Africans view this as not just a violation of their sovereignty, not just a, because of course Namibia, they view as their own sovereign portion of their empire, but a purposeful attempt by the British government to weaken South Africa's international eyes, to push this agenda that is starting to be developed. A year or two later, we have the
the declaration against colonialism,
like Hawkins and
colonization, and say we need to withdraw. Let's just withdraw from world economy. You know what? If they do not, if the United States and Britain don't want Namibian uranium, that's fine. Maybe the Russians will, as this way of counterbalancing this perceived aggression that they have. And so again, it's preliminary, but this, I really think that this case of Namibia, we really look at the way the South African imperial ambitions also drive it farther and farther away from the British Empire, as well as, you know, lead to eventual fall of apartheid.
We're more or less on time. We have time for discussion, but just to give you an incentive, stop the discussion at the right time. At 12:15, you can get lunch in room 1-6. All right.
I find the work very fascinating, and I encourage you to look into it further. The broadening of the issue of child labor beyond the kind of caricature where that we've been seeing. I think you're doing a very wonderful job on this attempt to coordinate, which is very good. In our kind of private discussion, I can tell you a little bit more about the child labor way in Nigeria, and in the way I can say I personally fit into the kind of thing that we're talking about. But let's leave that to a lunchtime discussion. My other comments go to Richard Roberts. I'm a little uncomfortable with the way the issue is being framed. We seem to be taking the politicians' statements about their objectives, about their motivations. We seem to be taking them as if that's really the truth. In other words, this whole idea about the spread of democracy, the Americans are going to Iraq so that Iraq will become the springboard for the spread of democracy in the Middle East. That's what we're going to Iraq to do. How seriously do we really have to take that? Isn't this just a matter of rationalization? Are there no other way, real hidden agenda that we are not being told? So why should we take that as really the motive behind the U.S. going to Iraq? And when we go to the colonial period and we talk about the civilizing mission, my query is the same. Why should we take that as the real motivation for Europeans going to Africa? And they begin to use that as a way of saying, okay, this is where they came. This is some consequence that they didn't anticipate. I find the framing of the issues a little problematic.
I guess it's really just you to answer because yours.
What can I say? I mean, one of the nice things about this, my effort here, is because, you know, part of it has to do with facetiousness. We all know that the rhetoric and the discourse at this high level kind of narrows the kind of public perception that's going on. Underlying that are a whole host of really complex sets of motivations, and you're absolutely right. We cannot believe the simplifying notions about the quest for democracy. Clearly, the military has its own particular agenda. It's an opportunity. Wars are always great for the military because they can lay claim on more resources. We have to be certain that oil plays an important role in what's going on, and it continues to play an important role in U.S. activities. Even Libya. Why did the United States invade? Why does the United States participate in Libya and not in Cote d'Ivoire, for example? Even though there might be some oil in Cote d'Ivoire, we don't, you know, get to that point. But the similar kinds of humanitarian excuses are not applied in formal. But I think that even if you begin to look at the kind of discourse about the civilizing mission, you can see within that, and particularly for the Bush administration, because I think that really Bush administration, Bush himself, actually did believe in these simple things. He was not a complex man. So he really believed this. And it was, of course, naive and silly that he did, but it does serve as a way of trying to help explain the other part of the story, the much more complex set of encounters that go on, and the opportunities that Iraqis had, the opportunities that Africans had under colonialism, to do their own thing, utilizing those kinds of, that kind of discourse, the kind of rhetoric, and the kinds of institutions that they had.
Yeah, Bob Whittaker, UT Austin. I had a question for Adam. I felt your paper was really interesting, and I appreciate your efforts to kind of, I guess you'd say, overturn the Oliver Twist thesis on speaking of Oliver Twist, I wonder how orphans fit into your ideas about child labor in West Africa. I think that you talked quite a bit about families and how children figure into labor within those, but I'm wondering about, you know, children who aren't protected by families, how they are incorporated into the economy. I mean, I'm sure that maybe it's not as much of a proportion as family-centered children, but, you know, of course, in, I imagine in the time period you're looking at, there's communal violence and, of course, civil war. And I'm just wondering if you can talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, so the situation of orphans in West Africa is a bit different than Europe in the sense that, you know, I didn't have a time to speak to this, but when you're talking about household economies in terms of West Africa, or Nigeria in particular, you're talking about kinship groups, extended family members.
Yeah.
So, and there's been a few articles on this idea of fosterage, where if a child's parents have died, or close relatives, that child moves into the next closest family, becomes a part of that family. Okay, now, the interesting thing about orphans is in, there's a large number of documents on child delinquency in Nigeria. And based on, now we don't have a lot of good numbers on some of these things, but based on the findings of some of the British officials, it appears that most often children associated with child delinquency, stealing, and so on, were in positions where they were outside the normal confines of the kinship group. That they were on the margins and weren't protected by those institutions. And one of the strategies of dealing with that would have been activities dealing with child delinquency, like executive boys, and so on and so forth.
Ready?
A brief question for our first speaker, Mr. Wool. And, pass over this briefly in your answer if you've already covered it, and I regret that I came in late. Do you go into your work the role of Sir Alfred Milner and Milner's famed kindergarten? And related to that, do you touch on, or is it worth mentioning, the attitude of liberal and labor foreign policy spokesmen towards the Commonwealth as peace-promoting international agency? And then finally, did each of these groups, conservative and labor, tend to have a racialistic view of the nature of the Commonwealth? And when does the idea of a multiracial Commonwealth enter the picture? I gather it's probably post-World War II, but I don't know the answer to those questions.
All right, so first of all, on the topic of Milner and the kindergarten, I didn't get a chance to touch on it on this paper, which is obviously very, very brief, but the ideas of the Milner kindergarten are very, very central to some of these ideas that I'm talking about in terms of the changing attitude to what I would refer to as imperial reform in the leading up to the end of World War I. In particular, it's Lionel Curtis and Philip Kerr, who two of these kindergarten members who form an organization called the Round Table, which I've briefly mentioned, but that's an imperial reform organization that Curtis turns into a propaganda machine for Imperial Federation at one point. He kind of fails at that, and the Round Table is a larger tent imperial reform organization. But and it's really fascinating. One of the things that I think is really interesting is the fact that these Round Table people are disproportionately represented when it comes to the British attempts to create the League of Nations. So, for example, Philip Kerr, who's one of the co-founders of the Round Table, is Lloyd George's personal secretary for foreign policy. Lionel Curtis gets an invitation because he writes an article in the Round Table journal called Windows of Freedom on the League of Nations, and
Robert Cecil, the British official in charge of the British delegation to the League of Nations, invites him along. Some of these more liberal or labor people are also involved, most prominently Alfred Zimmern, who was who's a very prominent labor or liberal imperialist, as you'd put it that way, but then becomes associated with the National Labor Party, particularly with Ramsay MacDonald. And in fact, Zimmern runs against Lloyd George in his seat in Caernarfon as the Labor Party candidate. He does not win. One of the interesting things, and I'll briefly wrap it up because I don't want to take too much time away from the rest of my colleagues getting questions, but this idea of these various philosophies, there is sort of a bizarre understanding and a very sort of similar attitude towards the empire that needs to become this international organization, or during the 1920s and 30s, that tends to transcend party feeling, with the exception, of course, of tariff reform, which is going to be the most divisive issue. And in terms of a multiracial commonwealth, I think you'd see tend to see around the board this issue of trusteeship, and first in India and then in Africa, that really is the spearhead of this idea of the fact that the British Empire is now no longer just an imperial organization extracting resources, but now we're actually training these various civilizations to, you know, be proper civilizations on the British model, and eventually come in to the Commonwealth as independent nations. That's much more complicated than that, but I'd like to—I should stop there.
Thank you. My question goes to Adam on child labor, and this is an area that I've worked on, and it's very interesting. My problem is that you may be essentializing child labor a bit, because when you talk about child labor being a source of socialization in the Nigerian context, remember there is the United Nations law on worst forms of child labor and an attempt to delineate child work from child labor. So when you're talking about child labor being, you know, kinship-based and a form of socialization, I think you may be talking about child work, because child labor is seen as being, well, you said it's not necessarily negative, and I do agree with you, but what do you mean by child labor? And you defined it as, you know, being productive services of children. In Nigeria, where I come from, you have a problem now with child labor being within the kinship-based situation, because you have children that are moving out of homes as a result of urbanization, as a result of globalization. There is a problem. It's not as kinship-based as it used to be. So there is that dislink between the covering protectiveness of the family and children that are gradually facing the world, so to speak, on their own. So these are nuances that should be, seen or addressed in issues of child labor. That's just what I wanted to say.
So I think one distinction to draw here is that I'm dealing with colonial Nigeria in the sense that I want to engage some current ideas, but at the same time, my research itself doesn't deal with past 1960. And so with the point of defining child labor the way I did is there are, as I mentioned, there is these associations we give, well, child labor exists because of poverty, or child labor exists because of this or this. And the point is, in the historiography, when you look at different things, of children in economics, say slavery, pawnship, hawking, all of these different things, you have people who are doing works on those individual things. Well, the point here is to draw a broader view and say, okay, how are these things related? How is child labor related among these different institutions? Why? What are the causes for kids to participate in particular activities like pawnship at particular points in Nigeria's history? So, I'm not sure if I'm completely answering your question, but I understand where you're coming from in terms of the contemporary issues. And I think that, I don't think that that necessarily dismantles my argument, but I think it, then we have to come to a point where we're saying, okay, things have changed since the colonial period, and so now what does that mean? Now, in terms of definition, if you want to label my thing child work instead of child labor, I mean, how you label it itself is not as important as understanding that what I mean by child labor is a much broader category that doesn't just mean piecemeal work or, wage labor. I think it is more neutral to say child.
My question is, you mentioned that the importance of the framing of India's constitution, especially that constitutional aspect. But from my understanding, the framing the Indian constitution process is maybe the when the parallel with several maybe another negotiation. For example, in your summary, you also pointed out the delicate negotiation about the starting balances, and also the India's final decision to remain within the framework of so-called Commonwealth, and its implication for the status of the Indian overseas within the British Empire. So it was from such kind of point of view, your topic is closely related to several more important big subjects. So how do you evaluate such kind of more connections with several more major topics in the process of the negotiations?
Okay, thanks for the question. I mentioned that in the abstract, but I did not have a chance to get into detail in my paper because of time constraints. But the reason I put those questions of sterling balances, question of defense agreement, and all those broader issues in my abstract is because I thought looking at the dealings between the cabinet mission and the British expatriates, they actually discussed all these issues. So the reason being that the question of what to do with the British businessmen in India, in an independent India, was actually linked to all these issues. And in the final analysis, because of the importance given to all these other issues, the question of we need to get a favorable treaty with and independent India for the sterling balances, and we need to make sure India remains within the Commonwealth, and we need to make sure how can we protect our strategic interest in Southeast Asia. All these were major issues, and weighed against these major issues, the question of to get a favorable deal for the British businessmen in an independent India, that seemed less of an option to both the British Parliament and the Indian government. So that's why I said that this issue is not just about the constitutional status, whether they are classified as minorities, whether they get special treatment for their business interests, but it's intricately linked to these broader issues. So I think if in a bigger paper, I would probably go into these bigger issues and then finally conclude which one way it most.
I have two questions for Jason. Hopefully they're short questions. The first one is the issue of sovereignty. Could you talk a little bit about how Namibians, the thing comes up Namibians, or is it still Southwest Africa? I mean, could you address that question. Like, is it Namibia or Southwest Africa?
Okay, it's technically Southwest Africa. Namibians, term Namibians coined by SWAPO in 1968. Is when it really becomes official in the 70s of the United Nations.
Okay, so could you, just, second question, could you talk about the issue of sovereignty, both how this
Namibians or Southwest Africans viewed themselves as a sovereign state, and also how South Africa viewed, were they viewing this as a sovereign state as well? That's my first question. My second one deals with the story you talked about, Hans Bude, was that his name? And what date was that?
1959,
okay. So could you talk, you mentioned among the sort of litany of reasons for why he goes to the United Nations is human rights violations. Could you talk a little bit about the relationship between his use of human rights and then the larger goal of sovereignty for Namibia or the creation of a nation state, and how these issues of human rights play into, or is it more political civil rights is what I'm really what I'm getting at.
Not short questions, but the sovereignty issues is you have this interesting, under the legal definitions, right? I mean, Namibia is was a League of Nations mandate. It tried to be incorporated by South Africa in 1945-46. That's defeated, but South Africa had always ruled Namibia from the moment it took possession as another province. I mean, and in fact, by the time you get to the 1940s, apartheid was almost practiced in Namibia before it was implemented on a larger scale in South Africa, because the population's smaller, geographic control's easier, because people are more spread out. But what happens is Namibia's definitions of what they want changes throughout the years, right? It's something in a larger project I'll really focus on. In the 1940s, 45, 46, we're really focusing on saying we do not want to be incorporated, right? It's like, we're not saying what we are at this point, but we are for sure not South Africa. And it's this big fight. In the 1950s, there's this big debate on what this means. You have a number of different groups, Prairie Chief Council of the Ovamboland People's Organization, the Cree African Organization, there's just tons of them. And 1960 is when SWAPO kind of comes together and says, we need a unified national program. Now, they're all working together in the 50s. But it's in 1960, really, where under Sam Nujoma, it's, you know, Bombo and outside of Van Hook, who's really saying, we need to consolidate things into a Namibian nation. And saying it is basically, because what had been happening is everybody is running their own campaign at the United Nations, right? They're all doing separate things, they're all, and this is just consolidation, but they're all going for the same thing. They're fighting at this point for a trusteeship for Southwest African Namibia, and that trusteeship, like it does to, you know, Tanzania and everyone else, will lead to independence in the early 60s. That's the goal. Let's go mandate, trustee, independence in 60s. That's, South Africans, of course, are fighting this, are the only people that refuse to convert it to a UN trustee. So, but South Africa, for their point of view of sovereignty, is that Namibia, under the League, under the mandate, is, they consider it sovereign South African territory. They view it as a possession of theirs, a colonial possession. I mean, I talk about South Africa as an imperial power, because they are. And they view it that way, as this measure of control. So that's a South African view, right? The Namibians the whole time refuse to acknowledge this. They fight against it throughout the 20s and the 30s and really in the 40s. Push forward. Now, with the human rights question, after 1948, or after 49, after the Universal Declaration of Human Rights is issued, Namibians change the language of what they use at the United Nations to incorporate those, so they can come and say, look, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights says that power must do X. South Africa is doing the opposite. And so they're clearly, now they're looking for political control, they're looking for independence. But the Declaration of Human Rights gives them another facet of arguing. Now they can argue not only are they not being protected as the mandate says they should be, and uplifted as the mandate says, they now have a certain language that they can use to push the thing. That's throughout the 50s. It culminates in 1959, which what you have is something called the Old Location Massacre. There's that. And Van Hook, as the white population is growing, there's some prime real estate that the white settlers really, really want, and it's a township. And they build a new township outside of the city in Kapitura, and they say, everyone, look, go to your new township. It'll be so great. They refuse to leave, and they're forced to leave. And the total dead's 12 or 13, and it's this huge outrage, and now that kind of culminates in this human rights development. And that's when it starts turning into more of a militant stance. But they really are using the language of human rights in the 50s. Now, it's still preliminary on what exactly they're saying, but it definitely is being discussed in Van Hook. You can read it in the Ovamboland People's Organization's Herrera, you know, the Herreros under, say, Kakos and Anglican Bishop or Minister Michael Smith to the United Nations, and he's using that language, and they are using it, to answer your question.
I have one more question.
All right.
Lunch is 1-4 down.